Thank you very much. Hello everyone, and welcome to the session. Thanks for being here. I know it's tough, you know, being the first session after lunch, and you know, people might feel a little bit sleepy. But I'll be presenting some of the interesting insights that we have gained on how, like, what is the state of structured authoring in our industry, which is TechCom, and I'll be sharing that in this session. So before I do that, let me give a very brief intro about myself. My name is Vikram Verma, and I work as product manager for RoboHealth, FrameMaker, and TCS. And as part of my role, I meet with customers, partners, go to conferences, and meet interesting people like you. And based on what's happening in the industry, we actually create the product, the next version of the product. So that's a little bit about myself. So essentially, I have divided this presentation into four parts. In part one, we will talk about some of the structured authoring adoption trends, like how many organizations are doing it and how that adoption is actually growing year on year. Then we would attempt to profile the organizations who are doing structured authoring, like what kind of organizations are they? Are they coming from a specific geo? Is there a specific size of the organization which determine whether they will be doing structured authoring or not? In part three, we will talk about how these organizations differ from each other, from unstructured authoring organization in terms of workflows. So are there specific needs which they have, and what are those? And then finally, in part four, we will talk about some of the migration lessons and key challenges that these organizations have faced or learned in their migration to structured authoring. So the first disclaimer is that this is not at all a tools presentation, so I will not be talking about FrameMaker, you know, at least for the most part, and I will not be doing any demo as well. So I'm just talking about, you know, what's happening in the market, what's happening in the industry, and what we see, what we have learned from product management perspective. All right, so this is my disclaimer slide. So whatever I show you in this presentation is not my opinion. So this is backed on hard data that we have got from various surveys that we have been doing over the past couple of years. In fact, the latest survey that we have, which is TechCom Survey 2014, it's still open, and I would request all of you as well to participate in that survey and help us understand our industry even better. So this is still open. I'll be showing a slide at the end with the URL so that you can take the survey. So based on these surveys, we have also looked at, you know, various third-party surveys which have been done by other participants in the industry. So we'll look at all those surveys data, and we'll try to make sense of, you know, what the data tells us about structured adoption. So let's talk about the adoption trends first. So first I'm going to show you the data from third party, like the industry experts who are based out of US or Europe, and they have conducted the survey. So the one thing which we can say is that structured authoring adoption is still growing, and it is one of the most prominent trends along with mobile publishing in our industry. So if you look at, so I have taken the surveys of Scriptorium, SDL, and Content Wrangler. Content Wrangler is basically Scott Abel's organization. So if you see, in 2008, SDL conducted a survey, and they found that 15% of the organizations are doing structured authoring. And that number, in 2009, two organizations did surveys, Scriptorium as well as SDL, and both of them, figured that probably the number of organizations, the percentage of organizations who are doing structured authoring is around 28 to 30% or so. So you can see that in 1 year, during that time period, it was a phenomenal growth. So it basically grew 100%. And then in 2011, the survey which was done by Scriptorium, the structured authoring adoption grew to 42%. And finally, we have one survey from Scott Abel, which says that in 2012, the adoption of structured authoring was 44%. Now, it's very hard to compare data adoption from different surveys. And the reason is because the samples are different. And sometimes the survey methodology is also different, because they might be targeting just the large organizations. They might be targeting the organizations in specific geos. But one thing that we can say safely is that the structured authoring adoption is somewhere between 30 to 40%, and it's growing, because from a direction point of view, we can analyze these data and figure out that yes, it is growing, and it is growing phenomenally. If you look at the CAGR, it's like 30% growth year on year, which is really commendable. And if you talk about our surveys, so our surveys, the methodology has always been like similar. So we can compare our survey year on year. And what we found was a little different, slightly different. We found that in 2012, 20% organizations were doing structured authoring, and that number grew to 28% in 2013, and it further grew to 31% in 2014. So now it's a little less than, you know, what the other surveys tells us. But then we had divided structured authoring a question into two parts. One was like, how many of you are actually doing it right now? And how many of you have started migration or planning to do in near future? So if you count near future and planning to do as well, then you will see that there is a further upside, which is of another 15% from now on. So looking at, you know, all these service data, what we can see is says that currently 30 to 40% are doing it, and still there is a huge growth potential. Another 15 to 20% will adopt structured authoring probably in the next 3 to 5 years. And in a steady state, more than half of the organizations, more than half of the technical writers would be actually working on a structured content. So that's the number one thing that we learned from the survey. Then we wanted to understand that, okay, the structured authoring is fine, but you know, what standards are organizations using? And we found that DITA by far is the most dominant standard. 57% of the organizations who were doing structured authoring said that they are using DITA. And after that, it's the custom structure. So basically, companies are creating their own structure. They're not using any other standard as such. As you can see, the like DocBook, S1000D, et cetera, are barely there. The adoption is very less. And the reason could be that those standards are specific to certain industries, and that's why the adoption is relatively less as compared to DITA. Another interesting trend is that there is a difference in terms of geography. So if you look at North America, you will see that DITA is more popular with 57% adoption, whereas in EU, it is 50% adoption. So clearly, DITA is more popular in US and North America. But in European countries, it's the custom structure. So most of the time, they are using custom structures, which is less popular in the US. So that's one key difference that we got in terms of standards adoption. And then we wanted to understand that, okay, you know, people are adopting structured authoring, and they are using DITA or custom structure. But what is the top reason? Why would you want to you know, adopt structured authoring? But before I share that, I would like to, you know, because now we have enough people. So how many of you are actually doing structured authoring? Can I have a vote, please? Okay, I think it's roughly 40%, which the survey also says. So how many of you are doing DITA? Okay, majority of you. What about custom structure? Okay, and what about the rest, like DocBook, S1000D, etc.? Okay, so then, you know, you guys are also very similar to the samples that we have. So we have seen similar thing. So let's look at what are the top motivations, like why would the companies want to do structured authoring? So what we did was we created a question and we asked the respondents that, hey, you know, we know from our research, our conversations with the companies that, you know, there could be many reasons. So can you rate those reasons on a scale of 1 to 5, 5 being the most important one? And what we found was that content reuse, document consistency, ease of update and maintenance, and easier publishing to multiple formats are the most important reasons, motivations when which leads the organizations to adopt structured authoring. And one interesting thing was that, you know, many during our conversations, some of the organizations did mention that, hey, you know, if you have your content in XML, the translation becomes much more easier. There is a cost saving in translation as well. But incidentally, that is the lowest, you know, like, I mean, in terms of importance, that was not that high among the reasons which were there in the question. So even though it is important, but I think the biggest reasons why the companies move to structured authoring is because of content reuse, consistency, and easier maintenance, etc. And so I'm going to show you some of the quotations that some of the customers have actually shared with us regarding, you know, what is the benefit that they achieve from structured authoring. So a large aerospace company says that it takes us 40% less time to create document in structured FrameMaker as compared to Word. So that's what aerospace company says. Similarly, a UK-based organization says that in our migration to structured authoring, we expect 10 to 15% of content reuse. Repurposing to newer deliverables is another new possibility. So when they started adopting newer output formats, that was also one of the benefits which they realized when they moved to structured authoring. Similarly, for a large smartphone manufacturer, you know, that's the quotation that we received was that they saw 65 to 90% reuse when they moved to data. Now, this is understandable as well because, as you know, in smartphones, majority of the specs or, you know, the technical details about the phones, different versions of the phones will be similar. So you can achieve a lot of content reuse. So it depends on the organization, so the kind of reuse that they can do. If the percentage of reuse could be like huge, then there is a very high chance that those companies would be doing structured authoring by now. And then there are other quotes which I'm going to skip in the interest of time. Okay, so basically what we learned in the first section was that, you know, hey, it's growing. 50% will do structured authoring soon. Data is the most popular standard, followed by custom structure. And then content reuse probably is the one of the biggest reasons why people would want to move to structured authoring. Now let's understand, like, what is the profile of structured authoring organization? So how does it look like? So the first hypothesis we had was that, you know, probably structured authoring is popular only in large companies. So how many of you think that large companies, it makes sense for them to go to structured authoring? Okay. And how about small companies? Does it make any sense to for the small companies to do structured authoring? Just one vote. Few words. Can you explain a little bit why? Why do you think so? For smaller companies? Yeah. Yeah, okay. Okay, yeah. Yeah, okay. So actually we found something which is very interesting, that actually there are two ends to of the spectrum. So you see the large companies with higher adoption of structured authoring, and you also see small, tiny companies as well, which have higher adoption. And whereas the middle companies like medium, small, so those companies have lower adoption. Yeah. Large companies?
Tiny companies,
okay.
Yeah, so if you go with unstructured framework, you have to design templates yourself and things like that. Mm-hmm. While data and these frameworks give you that foundation ready-made, so you can really go ahead and start authoring on day one. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I had a different interpretation to that, and I discussed with a few organizations as well. So we all agree that large companies, enterprises, it makes perfect sense. So there is a cost of migration, but because these large companies usually have like number of products, so the chances, the opportunity to do content reuse is very high. And plus they need to ensure consistency, and there are so many different departments which are working on the product. So in that case, it makes sense for them to move to structured authoring. Whereas in tiny companies, usually they don't have like multiple products. So the opportunity to do reuse is not that high. But still we found that the tiny companies, the adoption was high. And when we dig deeper, we found that most of these tiny companies are actually sort of professional services companies. So they are actually catering to large companies. So they are doing content authoring, but they are doing it for large companies. And in order to stay competitive, in order to survive, they have to be on the cutting edge. And most of the time, because the client is saying that, hey, you know, they have their content in structured form, so they have to do it. So that is the core reason why we see higher adoption in tiny companies as well. So because, you know, from product perspective, the chances of, you know, they are having content reuse opportunities are very less as compared. So that's what we found, which was quite interesting. But the good thing is that it's happening, so it's not that, you know, the medium-sized companies are not even doing it. So there also we see healthy adoption of structured authoring. So it's happening everywhere, it's just that wherever it makes more sense, wherever there are opportunities, the synergies are good enough. So there we see the the companies actually adopting this trend, structured authoring. If we look at the geographies, we said that, hey, is it local phenomenon or it's a global one? So there also we see that, you know, it's happening almost everywhere. So North America, the 40%. So here I'm combining those who are doing structured authoring and also those who are planning or migrating to. Remember, so there was 31%, 15%. So I'm combining them both. So in EMEA, it is the highest with 49% adoption. And in APJ, it is again 40% adoption. So one reason why EMEA, the adoption is high is because there the companies are like car manufacturing companies, airline manufacturing companies, and they have complex product, complex content. And the opportunity to reuse the content as well as to ensure document consistency, the need to ensure document consistency is pretty high. And that's why we see higher adoption there as compared to North America, where there the companies are sort of all kinds. And then we wanted to understand whether, what about the industries? So what do we know about the industries? So what we see here is that there is a difference. Everybody's like, most of the industries have healthy adoption, but then there are some industries such as telecom and high tech who are ahead in the curve. So high tech, as you know, it's the industry which most of the time defines any new trend, right? So they would be the first ones to adopt any new trend as well. Similarly, telecom, there is a lot of opportunity where they can reuse the content. So basically they are like creating telecom infrastructure and it's complex content. Whereas industries such as healthcare, now there the adoption is less because these industries are heavily regulated. So they can't just change their content workflows whenever a new trend is out there. So they need to make sure that everybody's it's regulated, it is approved by the regulatory body, and then only they can change the content workflows. So that's why probably it is less as of now. But the good thing is that in future, the laggards, the industries which are lagging behind are also going to catch up in future. So we see a good participation from all the industries. And this was another survey which was done by Data Writer. So there basically what they wanted to understand was that, hey, I know that a lot of organizations are doing data. So from which industries they are coming from? And as you can see that even though computer software and information technology services are the big ones, like 45%, but you also see participation from all industries. So data is something, a standard which is being used by all industries irrespective of where they come from. The next thing that we wanted to understand was like, we know that companies are moving to structured authoring. But what's happening? Do they have more software budgets or what's happening to their budgets as such? So if you look at our industry, so I will say that this industry is very stable in nature. So it's not like a very growing industry. If you look at, so we asked like, what has been the software budget trends in the last 3 years in your organization? And 50% said that it is more or less stable. So it has not increased or it has not decreased. 11% said it has decreased and 24% said that the budgets have actually increased. Now, I don't have the numbers for other industries, but I'm assuming that if you talk about professions such as digital marketing, you will see that the budgets for them would be like increasing, most of the time, year on year. And you will say more than 50% saying that the budgets have been increasing. So our industry is something like a stable one. But if you look at those organizations who are doing structured authoring, in that 36% of the participants said that the budgets have actually increased. So there could be two reasons. One is that they have adopted structured authoring because the budgets have increased and there was a need. The other reason is that there was a need and the budgets were not going to increase, but since there was a need, they were able to convince the top management to increase the budgets. And they were able to create a business case. So there might be a good business case which you can create for adopting structured authoring in your organization as well. Okay, so let's talk about the workflows and differences. So basically in the last section we have, we have learned, we have seen the data and figured out that, hey, it's happening everywhere. All the industries are represented. But the structured authoring adoption organizations have more budgets as compared to overall organizations. But what's the differences in terms of workflows? So for that, what we did was, so this is a, like a typical every category of workflows which a technical writer is engaged in, like author, collaborate, and publish. And we wanted to understand like how these things are different for a structured authoring organization. So let's talk about authoring first. So first of all, we asked the respondents that what kind of end user deliverable you are creating. And we found that there is a huge overlap. So the technical writing teams in general are creating multiple deliverables, user manuals, help systems, training content, et cetera, et cetera. And the interesting thing was that if you categorize the data into two parts, one for unstructured organizations, the other one for structured, you see that unstructured organizations, like people who are doing unstructured authoring, on an average, they are doing 3 deliverables, whereas for structured organizations, that number is 4.3. So this clearly states that as with the same team, if you want to create more deliverables, so the opportunity to do content reuse is high, and that could be the reason why they have adopted structured authoring. Then we also looked at the translation workflows. So we wanted to understand in how many languages you are either creating the content or translating the content, right? So if you look at unstructured one, it's on an average 3.4 languages, either they create or translate. But for structured organization, it is 5.5. So which is like 60% more than the unstructured ones. So as the number of languages that you work with increases, there is a high chance there could be a business case to adopt structured authoring. Then in terms of collaboration, we also looked at like, you know, there was this question like, what is the extent of collaboration in your company, whether it is increasing, decreasing. So in unstructured, 25% of the respondents said that the extent of collaboration in their workflows, at their work is increasing, whereas for structured it was 34%. So here also we see that the collaboration which is needed among peers, among SMEs and, you know, other people, that was much higher in structured authoring organizations. So there is a hypothesis. I couldn't pinpoint exactly why it is, but the hypothesis is that because, first of all, it's a complex content, and then because the migration is going on, so a lot of technical writers need to collaborate even more because it's not a steady state, since they are migrating to XML, and so that's why the collaboration required is much more. And sometimes it's like, you know, people who are migrating to XML, they also need to collaborate just to learn the new authoring style as well. So those are the hypotheses, but we have not been able to test it out whether that is indeed the ones or not. The other reason could be that because, see, collaboration will be more when for example, you will collaborate with your peer when you say that, hey, I want to, you know, use some of his content, or I want to just aggregate that, right? Which again brings to the same point.
When we talk about increasing the collaboration in the organization, I meant to ask that. Like within the team, it is obvious that we are going to collaborate more on this.
Yeah, okay. So the question was like collaboration with your peers and SMEs, but in your workflow. So, you know, if marketing team is collaborating with product management, so that is not related. But in your workflows, content creation workflows, do you see more collaboration? So, but we don't have a split on like with your fellow writers and with SMEs, like how it is increasing or decreasing. However, if we talk about collaboration pain points, so there we do not see like any differences. So both these organizations, structured or unstructured, they are facing a similar level of pain points, like the review process takes too long, merging comments from several reviewers is difficult, it's importing comments in the original source document is very tedious. So those are the pain points which have not been resolved, which means that for companies such as Adobe, like the vendors in TechCom, there is an opportunity. So if we can solve these pain points in collaboration workflows, we might have a good chance of succeeding in this market. So the other thing which we wanted to understand was, what about the CMS? Like how the CMS usage in these two kind of organizations. So this is the adoption for overall market for CMS. So in 2012, 49% of the organizations were using some form of CMS, and that number grew to 52% in 2013. And out of these 48% who are not using at that point in time, 4 to 7% were planning to adopt CMS. So CMS growth is there, but it's not as fast as structured authoring right now. But then one interesting thing which came out was that if you look at, again, if you divide it into two segments, so those companies who are not doing structured authoring, the CMS adoption is just 39%. And for those who are doing structured authoring, the adoption is 69%, which is huge. Excuse me. Which means that if the companies will adopt structured authoring, there is a high chance that they will also adopt CMS if they are not doing so. So the next set of CMS adoption growth is going to come from structured authoring organization. And if you think about it, like, you know, how would you reuse content? You'll need to have some sort of a repository, right? Either a CCMS or a CMS. So that's like sort of obvious that, you know, the adoption of CMS would be higher if you start doing structured authoring. If you talk about publishing, so we looked at the data and we see that, you know, okay, let's figure out how many organizations are publishing to, you know, more than one format and more than two formats. So this number that you see here, so this is like 77% are actually publishing more than one format, which is PDF plus some other format, and this is like more than two formats, 50%. But if we look at, again, in these two segments, structured and unstructured, we found that the number of organizations, percentage of organizations who were publishing to more than two output formats, let's say it could be PDF, HTML5, WebHelp, could be something else, CHM, HTML5, PDF, whatever. So for unstructured organization, it was 34%. And for structured, it was 69%. And if you remember, there was in the core reasons, core motivations, one of the reasons was that, you know, it's easier to publish to multiple formats if your content is in a structured form. And probably that is the reason we see that, you know, in structured organization, the number of output formats is actually higher. And one might ask, like, why is that? So one might ask that, why is that the case? In the sense, you can still publish even if you have unstructured content. But some of these organizations, for different output formats, they customize the content, right? So when they are publishing to mobile, they need to publish a different version. So from a single sourcing perspective, they need to customize the content in different output formats. And that's where structured authoring, if your content is in structured form, it really helps. It really becomes productive, because then you can pick and choose and specify which content you want for which output format. Okay, so from workflow and differences perspective, we see that, you know, structured authoring companies are basically writing more number of deliverables. They are translating or creating content in more number of languages. They're publishing to more number of output formats. So basically, you can treat these as sort of lead indicators. So in your organization, if those numbers are actually increasing, then there might be a, you know, business case to adopt structured authoring if you are not doing so right now. So let's talk about the migration lessons and key challenges. So firstly, there seems to be a skill gap which will need to be bridged. And this is like, this is very secondary level research. So basically what I did was I went to Indeed Resume and I searched for technical writers, and I found like more than 21,000 CVs. But when I searched for technical writer in XML, I found just 2,800 CVs. Similarly for technical writer data, just 500 odd. So as I, you know, started doing more structured keywords, the number of CVs started becoming less and less. Which means that only 10 to 15% may have the right skill sets. Or the other reason could be that, hey, you know, the guys who are doing structured authoring, they are happy, they are, you know, being paid very high, so they are not looking out. So that's why their CVs are not on Indeed. But we can see that if somebody wants to, if you have the skill set for structured authoring, you could be like the sort of premium candidate for any organization who wants to do structured authoring. And basically we also asked questions in the sense, so if you guys have moved to structured authoring. So what are the key lessons that you have learned? And then we categorize those lessons into various categories. So the first was in content conversion. So 44% said that content conversion is a big thing. And they have learned a lot in that. You know, some said that to do content conversion from unstructured to structured, your styles needs to be consistent, and then you'll need to create a script or relationship table so that you can move to structured. But most of the time, the content itself is not clean. And sometimes it's easier to write the content in structure from scratch rather than to clean up legacy content and do the content conversion. So that's one of the key lessons which they have learned, the organization. Then there was regarding change management, in the sense, you know, see, migration is a big project. Your content migration is a big project. And sometimes what happens is that you will need to make sure that all the stakeholders are on the same page and they understand the value of migration, because it's a painful process, it's a slow process, so there should not be that, you know, people feel demotivated in between when they hit some obstacles. So that's another part, like keeping everyone in the loop, keeping your stakeholders, and driving the change. That was another category where 22% people said that there was a lot of challenges or lessons learned. Okay, and 60% were also related to training on tools and structure. So when you're migrating, the current skill set might not be optimal, so you'll need to train your technical writers as well. Then 21% said that pre-migration planning, in the sense, sometimes what happens is that the organizations take decision that, hey, we want to migrate. But then because they haven't planned it properly, the entire process, sometimes they have to check and then start over again. So they say that, you know, you should spend a lot more time on planning and getting it right for the first time rather than iterating in the migration process. And then there is content reuse. So we heard about content reuse, right? But how are you going to reuse the content? That's very critical. So you should understand like what pieces you will reuse, how the whole workflow will work. So that's very important. It's good to say that, hey, content reuse will be better, but how is the critical part which you need to learn? And then there were miscellaneous things like creating business cases and things like that. Okay, so I'll just summarize with this slide. So basically, what are the key challenges when tech pubs move to structured authoring? One is content conversion, as I mentioned, that the content needs to be clean, consistent styles, and you should be able to convert it, have a good conversion, basically script or relationship table so that you can convert it. Then make XML authoring transition easier, because your existing technical writers might not be well-versed with the XML and structure. So you'll need to give them familiar tools as well as train them properly. Finally, seamless collaboration with SMEs and casual authors as well. So that's also critical, that, you know, whatever content you get. So if you are doing unstructured authoring, you can just copy-paste stuff, whatever you get from your SMEs. But if you're doing structured authoring, you need to figure out like how the content, whatever you get from the SMEs, is going to go into the structure and things like that. And finally, readiness for a mobile-first world. This is also, you know, one of the core reasons why people move to structured authoring, that mobile publishing is growing very fast, and you should think about how you can tailor your content to make sure that you are getting to mobile-first customers. So that's it, and just last slide. Actually, I have one more, but I'll quickly skip them. So we have two different products. One is FrameMaker family of products. So these products are focused on structured authoring, and then there is RoboHelp and TCS5 for publishing, etc. So I'm going to skip this. This is the last slide. So the survey which I talked about is still open, and there are 15 prizes to be won. So I would request all of you to please participate. And the URL is survey.doyouwriteright.com. That's it from me. And any questions, I'll be more than happy to take them.
All right. I think we'll just take one question.
Okay.
I think we'll take offline. So thanks a lot, Vikram.